anybody in here heard of what's called a clinical pathological conference, or CPC? Probably seen on TV. What happens is the pathologists like to trick the clinicians. And so they find a sort of bizarre case that they've done the pathology on, sometimes autopsy, sometimes other. And they give you a case outline to the clinician. The clinician's supposed to work through the case outline and figure out what was wrong with this mystery patient. And one of the honors is the residents, once a year, the guys in training are asked to do a CPC. They usually it's a real senior faculty member. And myself and down on the Norm Spank and others, adolescent medicine, were asked to look at this case of this child that had spent some time on Cape Cod and had a funny disease, and y'all know the rest of the story. Turns out he had lacking out of spotted fever, and it wasn't too hard to figure out, but it got me really interested in that and ticks. Learned all about the Shoshone Indians and Harold Taylor Ricketts, who is one of the most amazing epidemiologists who actually figured out why people that went up in the Lolo Pass in a certain time of year would come down and get this terrible disease. They did it all in a tent on the grounds of a little hospital in Baltimore. Anyway, I became very interested in another tick-borne disease, and subsequently I published a case report of another tick-borne disease. So there are ticks all around with all sorts of different problems, even though a lot of the press has to do with Lyme disease in this part of our country. I come from South Carolina, and a lot of people don't know that there's more Rocky Mountain spotted fever in the Appalachian chain, particularly the southern part of it, than in the Rocky Mountains. And it's very peculiar because if you get Rocky Mountain spotted fever in the east, you're more likely to get it, but you're more likely to live. And if you get it in the Rocky Mountains, you die, assuming you're not properly treated. So there's these enormous variations in the disease, again, a tick-borne disease. And so I've always had an interest in tick-borne diseases, which is why I, for some reason, almost accidentally, got assigned to do this workshop. So if any of you want to read one of the neatest stories, I go back to the Journal of the American Medical Association, I think about 2003, 2005, and do a search for Harold Taylor Ricketts and read his papers, which are just unbelievable about how he figured out what caused Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Because everyone thought it was some magic thing that came from air coming off of gopher probes or something like that. They had all these theories, none of which had much to do with the rickettsia. So anyway, we're going to talk today about ecological tick management. And you can both introduce yourself. I met both of these guys on the phone a few weeks ago. So, Daniel, you want to tell everybody who you are?
Okay, sure. Well, first of all, Dan Sonenshine. I'm a retired professor. And I got lucky when I retired 14 years ago, believe it or not. And they let me keep a small lab in my office there down at Old Dominion University in Norfolk. And so I've been playing with ticks and tick-borne diseases all my life. In 82, I started when I was in my early 20s, so before I had one of those. and keeps the neurons firing. They work with young people, they're constantly challenging their crazy ideas. But the fun of it has really, in the last few years, gotten to ask the question, how can we as scientists begin to pay back to the community? How can we bring our science in a helpful mode to try to really address this awful situation of ticks and tick-borne diseases in the United States? Particularly, how can we do it without pesticide, or minimal use of pesticide? Do we have the science? And I hope to convince you in the next half hour or so that we have more than you can imagine. And our problems with ticks and tick-borne diseases should be possible to resolve this, or at least make enormous inroads into this story, and we're not doing that for the kinds of reasons we'll get into discussing. I don't want to tell you the whole story of that. I don't talk too well about PowerPoint, so I'm going to go right into that. And I also want to say thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity to be here and talk to you about this, because this is my personal passion, as you can imagine. And I'm the sit down. I'm the only one. I've been here listening to every word since last night, and this is the first opportunity I've heard to really get into the tick story, so thanks for the opportunity to lead this. Let's see if we can get this out of it. So here's a very, very superficial list of all the terrible things that these things do. I think most of these names are familiar with you, to you. Rocky Mountain spotted fever, of course. Some of them have very long, almost unpronounceable names. You can use the acronyms like HME and HE and so on, and of course Lyme disease. 300,000 cases of Lyme disease per year is the current CDC estimate. That's probably an underestimate. The number of reported cases is about 1/10 of that, because they have to go through all the diagnostic tests and confirm them and so on and so on. And you can imagine a patient comes up, goes to a doctor diagnoses the tentative on symptoms as Lyme disease, gets a blood sample, and may or may not administer antibiotic treatment, usually it's doxycycline. And the thing goes away, the patient recovers, doesn't come back. So they cannot get a convalescent serum specimen to confirm it. And so it gets reported, but not as confirmed. So the numbers are going to be enormous underestimate of what's really out there. Look at the cost. It's in the billions. Do we have to put up with this? Why can't we, through our political advocates that we've been talking about today, our advocacy organization, that's one of the reasons that attracted me to do this seminar here, because we're a wonderful organization. I've gone away from the humble mode of the scientific talk, where I'm always very cautious and want to be exact and say exactly, everything has to be confirmed and very precise. So let's get on with a little bit of passion, a little bit of advocacy here, and see if we can make some inroads into this. So, I think I've presented the issues. Do we have solutions? I think so. Some possibilities. First of all, what do we know about tick biology and tick physiology? How can we use existing knowledge to greater minimize, better manage, without pesticide or minimal pesticide use, control ticks and tick-borne diseases? And what about transgenic ticks? Now, that's going to be a controversial issue. But it's being done. It's being done with mosquitoes. And they're knocking down the yellow fever mosquito, Aedes aegypti, with the risk of Zika. Right now, there's a company that is asking for and has gotten tentative approval to use a transgenic kind of mosquito. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And it's been tested in Africa against malaria. The question is, should we try it here against ticks? Should we put our resources in one direction or another? So I want to get that scene out right here at the beginning, and then we'll come back to it. So these are some of the goals to consider. Our resources are limited. What do we do with them? Should we invest in existing proven methods that will yield immediate relief? So that's where we should have put our resources. And we've got a lot of that, as we'll see in a few minutes. Or should we really start investing in the research promising new methods that could lead to eradication instead of control. The tentative goal here would be to eradicate a major pest like the deer tick, or eradicate the pathogen that the deer tick can transmit, such as the Lyme disease pathogen. Okay, so what do we have? We have the trap and kill methods. Now, the beauty of that is, instead of dispersing vast quantities of pesticide into the environment, and you've seen cattle dips, or pictures of cattle dips, where they have to round up the animals, take them off their feed, beat them over the head to drive them through this cattle bath. But I watched them do this. I could tie them on the head with a big two-way cord for them to dip all the way down into it. And then they come out, they drip all this stuff off, and they walk off of you. Because it rains on one board, it reaches off the ground. It doesn't matter. They're using carloads of chemicals to treat this condition. And if somebody is in Africa where if they don't treat them for a week or so, it's probably better. It's a huge problem if it's still a chemical. Or alternatively, they round them up like trucks and they bring them to a place where they spray. And they spray vast quantities of the pesticide. Or they use pour rods where they simply pour it over the back and this stuff reaches out and gets over the floor and the head and everything like that. Why do we do the opposite? They lure the ticks through the pesticide. So my colleagues and I came up with a tick decoy using pheromones. The male tick and the female tick only mate in most cases, the Lyme disease tick is an exception, while they're feeding on the animal. The female attaches, the male attaches, and the going with the reproductive system, and the female sends out pheromones, which have long elaborate legs that you don't even worry about, and the male recognizes that, runs over to it, identifies it, and starts moving with it. So what I do is we make up a little tick decoy. In other words, a little tiny plastic device impregnated with the pheromone and a pesticide, okay, we got pesticide, but a minuscule amount of pesticide compared to dipping the whole animal in it. And within a few minutes, it goes to fix. I'll tell you what that was early. We even put it on the tail of cattle. So we tested this in Southern Africa. And this one earlier was very susceptible to drought. And instead of using the most things in water, we got this tag on the animal. And we got 3 months of control with almost 100% tick kill. Okay, the deadly heartworm disease. We're very worried about that here in this country because they've made it into this river that affects that harbor the hot water disease region. And the islands in the Caribbean, such as Seattle region, and they're only just one flight away by these birds. But they fly over to Florida. I know about surveillance programs because occasionally a few of them have made it and caught the plane. Oh, I'm sorry. Talking to the microphone. I get passionate, so my voice gets up higher and higher, and you're probably hearing me anyway. So we put this on the tails of cattle, and again, luring the ticks to the tag, killed them all instead of letting them, depend on their natural environment. Another one is developed by a company named ISCA, I-C-S-A, called Splat, where they spray this stuff into the vegetation. It sounds like we're doing the opposite of what we want to do, but this is little tiny droplets that adhere to the vegetation and emit minuscule amounts of pesticide, just right around the surface of it, but a pheromone as well. So the ticks, these are deer ticks, that they crawl up the blades of grass and stems and whatever, and they start to adhere to this because they cluster to each other in the natural environment. And they get confused and think this little droplet is some of their mates, some of their compatriots, and they all cluster together and die. That's being tested right now. Here are some examples. The first one, the tick decoy. You can attach these all over the animal body in little pieces of Velcro. Use other methods of adhesion. And the fact that it looks like a little tick doesn't really matter. It's about the same size as a feeding female. What it does have is it's impregnated with these chemicals, including the pesticide and the pheromone, the males come over and try to mate with the zinc. I've actually literally seen them deposit their, what we call a spermatophore, the genetic material, you know, sperm-filled contents, into this little hole in the plastic. You can imagine that. And then they die. It is. My students called it fatal attraction. I didn't invent that thing, did, but we got 100% kill within less than 30 minutes. The second part of it you can see is without the pesticide, it shows you how long they lingered in playing with this little device, and eventually they gave up and attached to the body somewhere else. But down below here, there's the little tag on the cow's tail. So we turn the cows loose into vegetation, the ticks run over to the cow, they climb on board, and instead of all of the ticks going to their compatriots, because the first arrivals emit pheromone to attract others out of the vegetation, they all cling to this area around the tag because it's emitting all that pheromone, but it also has a trace of pesticide in it. So we got to try to get this commercialized. The farmers all over this area, Southern Africa, are screaming for it. Wow, we've got to have this because we had a drought. And we can't afford all the cost of the pesticide. We were selling that for like $1.50 or $2 or something like that for 3 months of control. Well, guess what? Went to registration, governmental authorities, and no success. And somewhere where the headquarters of these big pesticide companies, it was going to do what? You know, we're selling carloads, we're selling trainloads of pesticide chemicals. And they're crowing about how they can get the same results with trace amounts of it. And look at that's going to the bottom line. Uh-oh, we can't have any more of this. So we never got registration. We never got the factory going. That's the question. Yeah. But the same principle applies here. The same the question came up, why don't we have a vaccine against Lyme disease? The same basic principle. Not cost effective because too many lawsuits, people saying that your vaccine made me sick and sue the company and isn't worth paying for all the lawyers to just drop it. And here's the example of, this is very, very relevant because this research is going on right now. This is not commercially available yet. But this company, ISCA, ICSA in California, is running tests. I think they're going to have a very large government grant, and that's how they do it. And you see the little dollops that adhere to the vegetation, emitting pheromone and attracting deer ticks to it, and they all cling to that and die. We've had some success with that. I hope to see a great deal more. So that has a lot of promise. And then you have the four poster. I don't know if any of you have heard of that, where we got the idea of paint rollers. In the hardware store, everybody who's tried to paint their house knows about paint rollers. And paint rollers spin around to put them on a little post, which has a little center cavity in the center. And they put four of these together in such a way that the deer has to put its head past them in order to get to the food, such as corn, or could even use molasses. Deer like molasses. And they coated the paint rollers with an oily material containing a permethrin, is the one they usually use. Sometimes they use amitraz. So they use small amounts of pesticide. But now we're talking about what we call host-targeted technology. We're attracting the host to the pesticide, not just the tick. We're coating the host with trace amounts of pesticide, but we're not spreading it out all over the environment. And the results have been phenomenal. However, there is a caveat here, and that is if you're treating these animals near hunting season and the hunters want to take them back and then use them for food, this is not approved for human consumption. So some areas have actually either forbid it or have a lot of problems in registering this for general use. But it is commercially available. There's a company in New York called the American Lyme Disease Foundation in Somers, New York, is selling it. And in some areas, they're also making this available. And another very clever one is this one called Damamix Tick Tubes. You see that name up here, marketed by EcoHealth. And the idea here is mice will strip all kinds of narrow vegetative material like cedar bark, is really great for this purpose, and make nests. So they're very attracted to cotton balls. If you drop cotton balls into the grass and the vegetation in the woods, the mice will gather it up and take it to their burrows and nest in it. So they put out little tubes containing cotton balls, and the mice would come running to it and grab it, except the cotton balls are treated with a pesticide. So the mice are literally embedding themselves and their babies in a little bit of pesticide, and that's killing all the ticks. And this, again, is marketed. Important thing here, this is killing... Oops, let me go back. This is killing the immature ticks. So here we're killing the host of the adults, both the deer are the primary host for the adult deer ticks, Sodus scapularis. And the mice are the primary host for the larvae and nymphs of the deer tick. So no larvae, you're not going to get any nymphs. And the important point is the larvae are the ones that acquire the bacterium that causes Lyme disease while they feed on an infected mouse. Then when they molt into nymphs, they look for hosts again. They climb up a little bit higher, so they get on your dog, they get on you, any other animals. And they transmit the Lyme disease agent. But the size of the deer tick nymph is so small that you can fit it on the head of a pin, about a millimeter. Unless this thing is moving around, you wouldn't even notice it. And that's why it's so easy to miss. And it's why people generally do not see it until it's been either fully engorged or they never find it at all, and they only see the little rash around themselves, and then they see that big rash where they see the migraines, and then comes the Lyme disease. And if they think that's just a rash, or they find a little summer cold, like fever, they ignore it, and then you know the consequences that could occur later on, the chronic Lyme. And then you have the bait box. Here the idea, again, is similar to the other forms of host-targeted techniques where you lure the animal, in this case the mouse, into a little box that contains food that also is impregnated with a pesticide. So in this case, the animals self-treat themselves. This is another example of self-treating wildlife. And this is literally out there now being marketed by select ticks in Connecticut. And this could be sold through licensed pest control. I'm not sure homeowners can buy it directly. I think this is generally marketed through pest control companies. And then there are non-chemical forms. So here are just a couple of examples. These are natural products that use natural oils, fragrances of various kinds that are lethal to ticks. And Ron can talk a little bit more about the remarkable discovery he's made from some natural oils that have shown outstanding tick-killing properties. So we're not limited. In fact, I think this is a largely unexplored area that needs to be researched much more intensively. And one example, this is not a tick-killing agent, but a repellent, is a relatively new discovery called, the name of this is called Bio-UD. But the active ingredient is a product, I think it came out of a potato plant. Again, a natural oil that is exceptionally lethal to ticks, but very, very specialized. In other words, it's harmless to humans. So the beauty of these natural products is they have no toxicity. And they show tick-killing properties or repellent properties. And this one, we've tested it. I was involved in some of the testing. It has no known toxicity, and it compares very, very favorably. In fact, it's about equal to DEET, but it doesn't have that oily feeling and the awful odor that's very repellent for people. Personally, I agree with them. I hate to douse myself with DEET. You shouldn't put it all over your body. It's okay on the clothing, but a lot of people won't use DEET for just that reason. And just want to mention that first of all, I want to thank Congressman Pingree for her efforts in regard to advocacy for this. She's proposed a bill in the House, and a senator from Connecticut also to have a Senate bill in that he's proposed in the Senate to deal with the Lyme disease issue. We can get back to that later on in our discussion. Okay, and then the congressman in New York District also authored a tick-borne disease research and transparency accountability act. So we've got a lot of initiatives getting started in the Congress, but so far they haven't put any serious money behind all of this. I just want to mention, I just discovered this a couple of days ago, a $5 million grant made by the Kern Foundation to group in New York State called the Cary Institute. And they're introducing a whole novel way of approaching that. Rather than just selectively dispersing tick control agents, they're looking at where is the greatest degree of Lyme disease occurrence, selecting neighborhoods that are showing the greatest intensity, and matching that up with the highest intensity of pathogen infection in the tick population and the size of the tick population, and using those in individual neighborhoods as models for resource control. In other words, instead of dispersing your resources, targeting your resources very specifically to the real hotspots rather than the whole county. That's the problem. Our resources are limited. You just can't treat a vast area. You've got to go where the disease is most prevalent. And this is going to be a five-year study with really serious funding. But notice how much of this is coming from now from private sources. They're also, you know, getting matching money from the state and the county, but nothing from Congress. So that's another point we'll need to discuss. You probably haven't heard of this one yet, but this is one that I helped invent, which is a tick-killing robot. And we just published an article on it in Ticks and Tick-Borne Diseases last year. It looks like a kind of an evolution of a child's toy truck that ran around the woods, going around the streets rather than a little waterfall, a little handheld thing. So this one follows a guide wire, and it drags a cloth impregnated with a pesticide, permethrin. It doesn't release it. The ticks cling to the cloth and are killed. So there's no pesticide release into the environment. And that's about as no pesticide as you can get, and you'll kill ticks. And you can even use it to disperse odorants and pheromone, but I'm not sure if we want to do that yet. And here are some model designs about how it could be used. We had success with this in a city park in Portsmouth. We were able to control the tick population in the trails, in the meadows, in the recreational areas, within 1 hour of the robot running around dragging this cloth, and it lasted for more than 24 hours. So we were able to put up signs, literally and truthfully say, tick-free, safe for recreational use, with just that one robot. And the picture in the center here is a what a pest control operator could come out, get a layout of your property, and design a distribution for how the robot would operate. And of course, it's a little complicated, so you want a committed professional who knows what he's doing. If the robot runs out of battery, you can quickly make a repair and so on. Instead of distributing through homeowners, of course, if that fails, you're going to get a lot of complaints and spend a lot of money at the mark. And this is right now a prototypical example, but we just got a big grant from USDA for some studies to be done in Texas against the cattle tick. So we're hoping that'll work. And we've done some trials with it against the deer tick in New England. Most of our research has been against lone star ticks, which are hunter ticks. There are two kinds of modes of finding hosts. One is the ambush method, where the tick just gets up on a blade of grass or vegetation or waits. I think the tick is the case in point. And as you brush by, they cling to you. The lone star tick can smell from a greater distance and literally run towards you. It can cover meters in the course of a few hours. So this was very attractive to the lone star ticks because by doing this, as they migrated in, the robot would run around continuously. Wasn't it one time sweep? The robot was continually sweeping through there and gathering and killing ticks. Then we have vaccines, but not only not for people. This is the thing that really gets I actually started on the Lyme disease vaccine, and it was pulled before I ever got the third. It was supposed to have taken three versions of it. And I came back from my third shot, so some of the vaccines were pulled off the market. But it's okay, we have it, we can use it on dogs. We can use it out in the woods. We have it for wildlife, but not for you. Well, what we've done was rabies actually dispersed little bags of food that the raccoons come out and grab and eat. And it has fragments of rabies DNA. The fragment itself cannot cause rabies. It's not a full gene, but enough to initiate an immune response. And so people are doing the same thing using an oral bait that expresses the appropriate gene, or genes that's going there, expresses the appropriate protein that is immunogenic, and the animal then becomes immunized to it, just feeds on this, it's introduced orally. And when this was tested, they had 76% tick reduction, not tick reduction, but reduction of the pathogen, the name of the disease-causing organism of Lyme disease, Borrelia burgdorferi. And we still have everything in place. This is the beauty of the ecological approach here. We're not tampering with the ecology of the system. We're only tampering with the pathogen, which, of course, the deer does not need, the mouse does not need, the tick does not need. If we can get rid of the pathogen and get rid of the disease without tampering with the whole ecological system, that's not a bad thing. And lastly, I'll just briefly touch on the latest and greatest, which is genetics. And this is the foundation for the approach of the dream of the transgenic tick. One that still is around, still lives every way like it follows its normal natural constituents, except that it is unable to transmit the disease agent. And this is based on a new publication, I don't call it a co-author, the genome of the deer tick. We actually have the entire genetic code of the deer tick, and we just got an article published in Nature, which is a roadmap of how to use that genome information. So that gives us an immense amount of targets. But we also have a tool called CRISPR, C-R-I-S-P-R, and I can give you the acronym, the explanation of the acronym, but it's a tongue tie. And we have a couple of ways of approaching this. We have two basic tools. One is called RNAi, which stands for RNA interference. RNA is another version of the genetic material. So if you think about it, the DNA contains the genes, and each gene is expressed, it makes an RNA copy of itself, or a message, and it sends that out of the cell, and it goes to a particular part of the machinery of the cell that makes protein. And so that message codes for the protein that is expressed by that gene. The gene doesn't express the protein, it just codes the protein machinery to make that protein using RNA. So what we do with this thing is we make a mimic of that, and that mimic looks like that message, except it goes to the gene and it blocks its expression. We call it gene silencing. The neat thing about this is that we can administer this, and it's short-term. It'll last for weeks or months, or maybe even unlikely past the next generation. But we can withdraw it. So we're not doing any gene altering. This is not GMO. And yet it silences the target gene that is causing all the trouble. The other approach, of course, is the total gene modification, gene editing. So my colleagues and I tested this in ticks. We made a gene silencing RNA product that silenced the receptors for yolk. So in ticks, I'll be brief here. In ticks, the tick makes its yolk not in the eggs, but in another part of the body called the fat body. And it secretes that into the blood, and the yolk then is picked up from the blood by receptors on each of the eggs. We call the yolk vitellogenin, and of course the receptor is vitellogenin receptor. And the receptor captures that yolk and puts it into the egg or the yolk precursor, and there it gets converted to slight change into yolk. Without yolk, the egg is immature, the egg is not able to develop, the female doesn't lay any eggs. And in this model, I just drew a diagram that wasn't able to get time to get authorization to release the original article. You see on the left-hand side, the RNA result, the gene silencing, in ticks, the yolk is brown. It's got a little bit of iron in it. And you see all the white circles represent no yolk eggs. They are not going to be passed out of the animal. And when we dissected the ticks that were treated this way, the ovaries were all white, and all the compatriots that were treated never laid any eggs and they all died. We got 100% reproduction destruction. We stopped reproduction cold, dead in the tracks. And the control is full of brown eggs, they laid normal eggs. A single tick can lay over 5,000 eggs, so not a bad success story. We can also target the chemoreceptors on the forelegs of the ticks. Ticks smell their host with their feet. Sounds funny. But they have receptors on their the terminal ends of the first pair of legs that can detect ammonia, can detect carbon dioxide, a whole spectrum of different odorants, and identify those hosts and run towards them. And then other things come into play to help them identify that as the right host and bite and so on and so on. And we know what some of those genes are. We're now working on identifying all the others because we were able to make something known as a transcriptome. And as all the messages that are being made exactly in those little parts of the body. I mean, the information and the technology that we have now is so incredible that the students can cut off the tip end of a tick's leg and work on its genetics. And it's incredible. They can even identify the microbes that are in that little fragment. And I've actually given them a piece of the tick's leg, and the tick's still alive. And then I put it back on an animal, or put it back in the incubator, and they come back a couple of days later and say, oh, yeah, it was infected with Rickettsia or whatever. We have a Rickettsia binder called Rickettsia pocket. And they were able to nail it right to the species. But now we want to talk about, and just very briefly, the last thing I'm mentioning is the whole principle here of gene editing, where we can go in and using CRISPR, and CRISPR stands for, it deals with something known as palindromes, which are repetitive sequences all throughout the genetic system. And a company known as Oxitec has actually developed a method for recognizing and cutting out fragments of a specific gene that they're targeting so that the gene is inactive, or they actually destroy it. Or they can alter it in other ways. They have to inject eggs, and this picture you see there is the story there is showing injecting under a microscope. They also inject the eggs with a fluorescent target so they know which one succeeded or not. That's what those yellow and red things are, green and red. And some of the eggs, a lot of them die, but some of them succeed in hatching, and then they can rear these, and they keep on doing this until they get thousands upon thousands of mosquitoes that come from this, and they release them into the environment. So now we're talking seriously GMO, but this is being developed by a company called Infexon, who acquired the technology. I've done some work for them myself. And the field test with this technology against certain mosquitoes has showed up to 96% mosquito control. So the question is, if they can do it there, should we try it with ticks? And this is the story about CRISPR. Not only does it exist in the laboratory, there are kits out there that have investigated this, and you can see companies selling these kits, and they tell you how to do it. They have workshops and teaching people how to do it, and you can build a population of your own species containing these strategies and make transgenic mosquitoes, transgenic ticks, whatever you want to make a transgenic of, and use it to achieve control of the natural environment. Buy these clips. So whether you can do anything with it in the natural environment, you better get FDA approval or whatever, EPA or somebody else's approval. But if you're using it for lab tests, it's only right now that company, Infection, has appealed to, I think they've gotten temporary or tentative FDA approval to release it. I think it was in southern Florida, maybe in some islands of the Caribbean. I couldn't remember exactly where. Tentatively, there's going to be some hearings on this, and already a certain amount of resistance is starting to build up to it. But people are very terrified of GMO. In this case, you see, we're dealing with a one molecule modification in a target species, one species of mosquito. There's little chance that any of that can migrate out into other mosquitoes or beneficial insects. At least I don't see how it could. But we have to hear the opposition and find out through hearings, you know, how realistic this is. So briefly, we have a bunch of different molecules that I just mentioned that are possibilities. Ticks secrete this one here at the top. These deer ticks have a specific receptor for the bacterium that causes Lyme disease called TROPSA, tick receptor outer surface protein or OXA. None of the other ticks have it. That's why the deer tick is a specific vector for the Lyme disease bacteria. And if we could knock that one out, we'd have a sequence. Or they secrete these anti-hemostatic things, anti-inflammatory and anti-hemostatic. You take that away, you're going to itch like crazy every time you get a tick bite. You do that. Not like a mosquito. People don't even notice that we've had a tick bite because the tick has this mechanism for suppressing all of these natural reactions to the tick bite, as well as coagulation and so on. And we know about the molecules in their pharynx, blood sucker, about the molecules in their digestion. They are not only exclusive blood feeders, but they're almost exclusively feeding on hemoglobin. They're so narrow and they're special. They're so vulnerable. Now that we know what the digestive enzymes are, we don't know the whole pathway for hemoglobin digestion. Just knock out one of those molecules in the pathway, you can't eat. That's fine. They can drink, but they can't digest the meal. And others that we have, we know about other tick-specific genes that facilitate reproduction, and the list goes on and on. So we have a whole pathway of things. We know the entire genetic sequence, and we have a roadmap for how to use it, and how to go after some of these. So those are some of the possibilities. So I'll summarize with this slide, and throw this out at you. From everything you've heard, and you can see we have on the left hand side, commercially developed, in development right now, a very advanced state of field testing that could be commercialized, and yet we're not seeing those deployed on a national scale. The companies involved are small, they're making little money, not even sure how to get there yet, and we're not seeing a huge amount of government infusion to help them along to say, hey, keep going on this and start using it. Should we really put our resources in this direction and try to get there this meeting because it's really rough and really fast? Or should we go in this direction and say, well, the advantage here may be long term, we have to wait a while, and it's going to be costly and risky, and we don't know if it's all even going to succeed, but the long term benefit could be quicker adaptation, not just quicker fall. And that, and stop, and hopefully I'll provoke you enough. Let's see what you think.
My name is Ron Circe. I'm a biologist, ecologist actually. I was one of those people that the funding was so great that I spent my entire academic career at one school, Texas A&M. I get that a lot up north. They're going, where? But I did. Right after that, I spent 20 years with the U.S. Geological Survey as a researcher. I've been a consultant ecologist, both in Texas, where I'm from, and in Virginia, where I currently live. For the last 15 years, I've worked for Loudoun County, a local government, literally about 30 miles due west of Washington, D.C., to kind of set the geography for you. Loudoun County is the fastest growing county for like the last 10 years in the United States. In 1990, there was a population of about 86,000. 2014, the population was about 375,000. So in a generation, it went over 400% population increase. I was hired 15 years ago to manage a place called Banshee, Reeks Nature Preserve. 725 acres. The largest piece of property that Loudoun County owns. I have half of my staff here with me today. Just last week, I was able to hire my second staff person. I was able to hire a naturalist. We are now the only two biologists working for the entire Loudoun County. That's it. Loudoun County has no environmental program. They have no environmental manager. I'm kind of setting the stage here to build up to what we do and don't do at Banshee Reeks Nature Preserve and what Loudoun County and Loudoun County Parks and Recreation has come to do in their other sites. So back in 2010, there were some citizens who grabbed the ear of several of our board of supervisors and convinced them, number one, that deer are the cause of Lyme disease, and number two, all the playgrounds and the ball fields that are manicured and mowed are where the ticks are. And so, our board of supervisors decided to spray with bifenthrin 9 different parks. Now we have 9 members on our board of supervisors. 9 members of the board, 9 parks. Correlation, you think? Huh? Right? So every supervisor got a park of their choice. Well, the supervisor that chose Banshee Reeks, the district I'm in, a little sidebar. I've already had a really nice career with the USGS. This is my second career. If you want to fire me, fine. Okay? I'm old enough that I don't mind poking the hornet's nest with a stick, right? I don't run that fast. I still get stung, but I don't care. I'm a scientist. I felt I had science on my side. And I still do. Still do. But I've got scars on the back of my hands where I've been slapped down. Doesn't matter. They haven't been fired. So this board of supervisors decided that he, in his district, he wanted to spray Banshee Reeks. So I spent about 4 days down at George Mason Library. I'm adjunct there, so I could go in, get into the medical research library, sit in the library until the librarians come out and go, oh, seriously, go home. Dug down into the literature, drilled down deep as I could. And another little sidebar. One of my heroes in science is the late Paul Sagan, the original Cosmos guy. Okay, not that I have anything against Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's fantastic. Carl Sagan, one of my favorite quotes in science is Carl Sagan said, the best thing about science is not that you're going, aha, there is no Euripides moment like that. There's no Archimedes moment. It's, wow, that's weird. And that's where questions in science come from. Where you're sitting there, whether Dan being in the laboratory, you know, or Routt being in the lab, and you see some anomalous data point, you go, ooh, that's weird. So you start down that rabbit hole. Okay. So I was drilling down through the research, and I got to one of those papers. I was just reading the titles just to see if they were good. And I got to a point where I read this paper and it said the efficacy of DEET and cedar in the prevention of ticks. And cedar? That's weird. I had $30. I had $30 at the time. And I'm thinking, I've got 3 dog beds at home. My living room and bedroom smell like cedar, like hamster cages. Because those beds are made of Cedar, Wright, PetSmart, Petco, any place like that. You want to buy these pet beds, they're made from cedar shavings. And on the packaging it says to help prevent ticks and fleas. It's a deterrent. So, I started gathering all this information. Wrote a white paper, then I sent up through the Parks and Recreation, up to the Board of Supervisors. About a week later, they started spraying the other parks. Now, they had no data. They had not gone out and collected any data whatsoever. All they were taking was somebody in one district complaining that the deer cause Lyme disease and that all these manicured playgrounds are where the ticks live. Well, they knew this white paper was coming up the line, so they kind of went,
let's not spray Banshee Reeks.
So they decided not to spray Banshee Reeks. Because they knew the stick was coming to the hornet's nest. So they didn't spray Banshee Reeks, but they sprayed the other eight parks without any data. None. Well, being a public servant, I can't do a lot of advocacy directly. But I have friends. I have my own private email account, not just my county government account. So, I rousted up a bunch of friends. And the proverbial hit in the fan, it did. Because it came out that these people, the government, had sprayed without any data. None whatsoever. Spraying by fentanyl. Right? All over these parks. And then what freaked people out even more was the fact that Parks and Rec had to go up and put up signs, do not play on these things for like 4 days. They sprayed them in wetlands. They sprayed this in waterways. They sprayed it in drainage. They sprayed it on fields where the very next day they had irrigation systems going. And I'm standing there going, really? So, when it hit the fan with the public, they went to the Board of Supervisors and they went, oh, well, I'm sorry. We were depending on this over here. This person was telling us about all this tick data and this data about Lyme disease and where you get it from. And then this one group who had gotten some information from it wrote a paper and made it public. And it embarrassed the board so much. I went home and had two beers that night in celebration. I had three the night before for being depressing the whole thing, right? But two in celebration. So this paper went up to them from this organization, and it listed all the science. And then the board started apologizing. Well, the person who had first pushed it, this non-science person, got raked over the coals by the Board of Supervisors. Rightly so, to some degree. But this other group raked the Board of Supervisors over the coals. Washington Post raked our supervisors over the coals. That was embarrassing. That was embarrassing to them. So, 6 months later, what did they do? They let out a contract to hire someone to come and do a tick survey. Well, a little late, never. The horse is gone, so go ahead and close the barn door, right? But they hired someone. So, they had them go out to these same parks and do it. And the Board of Supervisors was convinced that the only ticks they were going to find were black-legged ticks, exotic scapularis, the deer tick, the one that carries the boreal or dwarf-like bacteria. Well, anybody care? They found three species of ticks. The most predominant species was the lone star tick, second was the dog tick, and third was the black-legged or deer tick. What do you think the percentage of, just let's take a guess, the percentage of black-legged ticks collected in nine parks, a total of about probably close to 1,500 acres in Loudoun County. What was the percentage of black-legged ticks? Anybody have a guess? A little bit more. 3%. 3%. 3%. And the thing about black-legged ticks, I was talking to Dan about this morning. one of the things I do as the manager of Banshee Reeks, I come up with a thing about 4 or 5 years ago. I teach a 1.5-hour presentation on tick ecology, right? The ecology of ticks. It's not all my research. I will admit that. I actually got it from, Dan had it up there, the Cary Institute in New York, a guy named Richard Ostfeld, O-S-T-F-E-L-D. In 2011, published a book called The Ecology of Lyme Disease. Fantastic read. It's not pure science. There's a lot of science in there, but the way Rich writes it, it's literally anybody can understand it. Okay, you don't need a science background, but some great information. Great information. So I patterned my talk on tick ecology to that, to Rich's book. So, 3% of all the ticks. And black-legged ticks, primarily, not always, but primarily found in wooded habitats. So what they found was in these places where there was balsams, manicured grasses, did they find any black-legged ticks? No, they didn't, right? The only place they found them was my place because they were out in the woods somewhere, right? And so the Banshee Reeks got a huge number of black-legged ticks. I said, well, the only place we sampled was in the woods, right? What about the other 450 acres of grassland I have? You didn't sample there, right? So, once again, the board of supervisors got very embarrassed because the science was bad, very bad. Now, all this is going back. Remember I talked about I was in the Mason Library, Medical Library, found the cedar and the DEET article, okay? So while all this was going on, this took several years, I found a place in Texas called Cedar Oil Industries, cedaroilindustries.com. I started buying cedar chips. Now, these are small. They're made from both the eastern red cedar, which is actually a juniper, but it's not clear about botany. Nancy might. But eastern red cedar, some of the western cedars, it's about the size of a large piece of fertilizer. Okay? It's not very big. Not very big. It's not like the shavings you get from your hamster cage or something like that. Small chips. So we've got some of that. And now I live on Banshee Reeks, right in the middle of the 725 acres. My house is literally surrounded by woods. I've got a little quarter acre front lawn in the backyard. The rest is all wooded. My dogs go off around that bit. So I put the chips, put them in the fertilizer spreader, spread them all over the front yard. Because that's the only place my dogs go. I also bought cedar oil, sprayed it around the perimeter of the yard, where the woods and the yard meet, and the base of the house. Now, this was April, so our ticks are out by then. July, not one of the dogs had a tick on it. I'm like, huh, that's weird. Because what I do, and this... All right, this kind of shows what a field ecologist does. I keep a vial in the drawer on my coffee table. I fill about half full of alcohol January 1st. And that vial stays there all year long until December 31st. Every tick I pull off of me or my dogs go into that. Because one of the things I do, right, it's kind of weird, you grab a special ice cube. Sit down and identify all the ticks. Then I've got this real nice silver-plated bowl that when I got divorced, my ex-wife didn't want it. I'm like, ooh, I know what I can use that for. So I go on the deck. Alcohol burns cool. Pour it in there, and it's my knot killing the ticks, even again. So I get to identify. So I've had years' worth of data that I've been collecting all around the house. So when I started applying the cedar chips and the cedar oil, it got to the end of the year, and I'm like, yes, December 31st, I get to go out and I get to burn my ticks. I'm like, it was like 7 ticks. 7. Okay, that's not hard science. That's anecdotal. But I'm here to tell you, I am a convert. Total convert. So after that, I started putting it on real popular areas at Banshee Reeks where we have a lot of people. In our picnic areas. We do a lot of restoration, natural resource restoration, field restoration. We cut down a lot of cedar trees. I convinced my boss to let me buy a big chipper. We go in and we chip all that stuff out. And we spread that around, right? And it's working. I use it on my dogs, cedar oil. My significant other jogs out there with the injuries. And she jogs with one of the dogs. So we'll take a 1% solution, spray it on his undercarriage and his legs. She can jog anywhere she wants to with him. No ticks. Wow, that's weird. And one of the things I noticed after we started using the cedar chips on the trail is how few ticks there were. And the reason I could do that, again, this is anecdotal to some degree. At the time, I had two dogs. I had a basset hound, or a beagle. It's, everybody knows what a beagle is, you know, scent hound, big ears, like that. Okay, it's a basset hound on stilts kind of thing. Right, same kind of, always walks with its head down, right? The other dog I had was a Basenji. Everybody heard of Basenji? African sighthound. They're not real big. They're both rescues. Not real big. Very erect head, erect ears. They're always looking out here. He doesn't care what's here. He wants to know what's out there. So I could walk him down the trail. And my trails at Banshee Reeks are 6 feet wide. Because they occupy old farm roads. Because it's been a farm since the 1840s. So I reoccupied as many farm roads as possible because I figured, well, I'm doing a little ecological damage because it's open to the public, right? So I walk both these dogs down the trail. The basset, the beagle, walking down the trail going like that. And the Basenji going. Dan alluded to it, mentioned it a while ago. When ticks quest, the Howard's organs in the front feet, you wave them around, they're sniffing for CO2. Which dog you think got more ticks on it? The one going. That's the beagle. The beagle's right here on the ground going. But now, and Basenji's going. Like that. Okay, so. And again, anecdotal. But once we started putting cedar chips on some of the trails, some of the more popular trails, you could walk them down there. First time I did it, got to the bottom of the trail by the pond. Buford. That's the beagle. So anyway, picked him up, looked at him. You said, how many ticks you got on him? None. And by that time, he had usually like 6, 7. Well, it hadn't stuck, but you could see him crawling on him. So I'm like, that's weird. So we tried it again. I let the cedar chips, they don't last forever. Depending on weather, precipitation, they'll last anywhere from 6 to 9 months. So the next year, before we put him down, I hiked him out the same trails. He got about a dozen ticks on him, the beagle. Basenji, none. Okay. Let's wait a couple weeks. Did it again. Same thing. The beagle got ticks, the Basenji, none. Well, the Basenji gets like 1 or 2. Did this a third time. Same thing. So then we spread cedar chips. I waited a week. A week after we sprayed the cedar chips, went down, beagle got no ticks. Again, semi-quantitative. I wasn't taking field notes or anything like that, okay? But I have become a true convert using cedar chips in lawns, in grass areas, and cedar oil. Cedar oil around the perimeter of a building, cedar oil on edges, cedar oil on my dogs. We used to use permethrin and wear gaiters, right? Either low or high gaiters. And soak them in permethrin. They'd be hanging up and dripping for days before we could use it. We kept doing it. We actually threw those away, bought brand new gaiters, cedar oil, that's it. If I could get my gaiters, cedar oil right on my boots. 1%, that's all we've been using. Yeah, we smell like we just walked through a field of hamsters, but that's okay, right? I'd rather have that. I'd rather feel like I just wrestled a hamster to the ground than have all the chemicals on me. I don't want the chemicals on me. You know, I grew up in the era where we would sit literally on the curb in Texas watching the DDT trucks go by. Here. Hey, guys. Hey, guys. You know. So, I've got a lot of that stuff in me. And that doesn't account for many days of undergrad school that I don't know what happened. Right? That's a whole other story. Not going down that road. All right? But, Supposedly, I saw Janis Joplin. Keyword there being supposedly, right? Don't remember. So, better living through chemistry. How many remember that? Yeah, right, okay. Yeah, well, I'm still alive. So, I guess my takeaway for this, and one of the things I talk about in my presentation for tick ecology, my second to the last slide of my presentation, there's an organization, Honest Scouts on it, and I'm not condemning it by any means, just I use it as an example. It's called the Flat Earth Society. For $25, you can become a member, you can get the t-shirt, which is really a cool looking t-shirt, by the way. It really is an awesome looking t-shirt. It's an international organization of 600 and some odd people worldwide that are members. And I use that to tell people, be careful when you look at the internet for information. Because whatever you already think of, whatever you already have an idea for or a philosophy for, or you want just acknowledgement, you can find it on the internet. I had a friend, I used to be adjunct at Shenandoah University, a little private one in Winchester. He taught sociology. One of his assignments to juniors and seniors sociology students was, and computer science, is it was a multimedia, it was a, not multimedia, what's it called? Mass media type thing. Facebook and that Twitter stuff. Social media. Right, your social media, thank you. That's it, well, I'm impressed, so, well. Color me, I am not worthy. Color me impressed. He gave him a challenge to go to a Wikipedia page, and you can change it. Because it's not refereed. Everything that we've ever published, any scientist that's ever published, has to be refereed. You don't just write a paper and send it to the journal. No. You know, this isn't Life magazine, right? It goes through a lot of iterations. So none of that stuff is refereed. So I used that slide about the Flat Earth Society. Again, no condemnation on the Flat Earth Society. My grandfather, bless his heart, still didn't believe me. He died, then we went to the moon. His choice, it's all right. Fine. But he taught me to eat raw oysters, so that was good. He's good. Be careful what you look for on the internet, because if you walk into something already believing it, you're going to find it to support it. Okay? What I tell all my students when I teach is, if you want to really search on something on Google, don't go to Google. Go to Google Scholar. Right? Because then all you're going to find is academic papers. Not just science, but sociological papers. Any field that's got real journal articles, you find on Google Scholar. Right? Not WebMD, not Wikipedia. So, let me make sure I've covered everything I wanted to cover. That's it. Thank you all very much.
So, I'll open it for questions, but I want to make one more comment. I think it was 2 or 3 years ago, I got a call from some folks in Maryland about a study CDC was doing to control deer ticks, which was actually ticks in general, which is they selected, I think, 200 homes in two states, Colorado and Maryland, and were putting a perimeter barrier around them. I believe it was permethrin. Anyway, it was a pyrethroid. And they had done it for a year, and they had controlled, and it was a controlled trial. They had properties they were doing it and properties they weren't doing it. And they compared the tick counts in the first year of study in the two types, the control and the active group. Result was no difference. And so they said, well, we didn't study enough houses, and maybe we'd do it right. We want to do it again next year because we didn't find what we wanted in the first year. And I ended up in conversations with the Commissioner of Health in Maryland, finally got them convinced not to go ahead in Maryland, but they did in Colorado. I haven't seen the results, but, huh? So, yeah, I mean, the stuff I've heard today sounds like there are some a little more potentially effective and perhaps progressive approaches to tick control. And despite the service of CDC wanting to, you all know this saying about insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. That seems to be the CDC's approach to tick control.
Go to a university, Department of Entomology, if they have one. And if there's any funding that you might get for a graduate student, or even some undergrads, very modest costs. And quite a lot of data. In fact, this is the time of year to push that because it's now April, so the dog tick season is just getting going. The rose star tick season, the adults will reach their peak next month. The deer ticks, we'll still find some from this past winter, adults coming out, and then the nymphs are coming out soon. And that's the most dangerous part of the deer tick cycle, is the nymph. So, in Rockland, well, deer ticks, black ranger ticks, fantastic. So I think this is part of the climate change that we're all familiar with. Question? Yes, sir. The Indian communities, before the colonists arrived, there's evidence that they had it. we find evidence of Lyme disease in ticks that were collected around 1800 and still in alcohol. We still find the bacterium. The early settlers were just settling that far end of New York and Montauk Island and Montauk Point at the end of Long Island. And the list goes on and on. This is not a new disease, but it's a new discovery. So, I mean, what you're bringing up is we're beginning to recognize conditions or diseases that have been around for a long time that we're just first identifying. So, I think there's a question about that. That's the question that I'm posing. Do we want to use what we now have, which includes, by the way, gene silencing, or should we invest in a lot of research? We're talking millions then. Yeah, or not with GMO. And what I'm looking for is more interest in advocacy, more interest in reaching out to our politicians, more interest in we, and this one, really excited to be before an advocacy group like this. We don't have to accept the millions of problems that we have here. We don't have to accept 300,000 cases of Lyme disease a year. Or we just passive about it and just say, oh, my son had, like you said, my two sons have Lyme disease, and we can treat it. Because the medical professional will tell you, no problem, you get sick and treat them. What about all the people who don't get to a doctor in time? They don't even know they have the disease until years later they find out they have these chronic problems where the doctor said, you should have come and seen me. I could have treated it, but what good does that do? It shouldn't be out there. Good question there.
I'm out in the field probably 3 days a week. I put it on 3 days a week. I've had lines for 25 years. Chronic efficiency as well. But I just want to go.
said, you know, we're living in a slightly cooler climate. And I've never had any issues with Bill, which has been true. You know, it's a Christmas tree that kind of trip.
How big is that hamster?
No, not yet. Not yet. Eucalyptus, rose, and geranium have also shown some efficacy in particular baby plants, but the number one that actually was tied to deep is cedar oil. Cedar oil and deep are like this, go ahead and go. Others will do it, but not with the efficacy of cedar oil. Mm-hmm. Dogs will also recover within 24 hours. I couldn't remember when my dog had a real dog. And literally laying on the floor in the morning was fine. Knew exactly what was wrong, couldn't not think of that. You know, in 24 hours, it was like, I mean, they bounced back up the court. But the vaccine for dogs is not necessarily 100% going to be what did it. It's just that if they do, it's generally less.
Where that vaccine works? It's a target to the receptor I was talking about. So the bacterium can't latch on to that particular part of its body because the receptor is blocked by the vaccine. So the ticks pick up the bacterium from the mice, but the bacteria just lay there in the gut and eventually just because they can't latch on, they can't get a protective mode. So you take most of the next life stage, it is free of the bacteria. That's the hypothesis. Well, you know, guess what? Nothing is that perfect. There's only a few receptors that are hidden somewhere, and some of the bacteria managed to latch on to that thing. It's enormously, I mean, greatly reduce it. Enormously reduce it. And maybe some in which the whatever reason that vaccine molecule. There are always small imperceptions in it. But this is old technology. That was developed in the 90s. Why can't we come up with something new? With all these new genes that we have, that I've been talking about. The science is there. But the money from industry is not. The money from government is not. The research is not getting done in a meaningful way. When I investigated what's going on with National Science Foundation, they said that your grant is the only one on checks in the entire National Science Foundation. And you did a great job, and really scored with all the accomplishments that probably the next.
So I've got a very narrow window of winter, right? 55 to 60. 60, that's summertime. I'm in Florida, right? That's it. Right? So, cedar oil in me, no problem. CedarOilIndustries.com. And no, I don't own stock. Yes, I do, but I get a minimum 1% of my balance in my stock. One part cedar oil. 1%. A tablespoon per gallon is how much.
You know, it makes you wonder why don't we find out what is the active ingredient?
Yeah.
But what is it in cedar oil and make a product? How can you control, and this is true of any of these other natural products, how can you control the delivery if you don't know the active ingredient? You can't do a dose response test. They want you to use, you know, what the chemical industry is putting out. I take that back. Some of my colleagues have done so in the laboratory experience. That's one of the very fishing expeditions. Go ahead, sir. With the robots, we've got two machines right now. No money to make it. No accelerator for it. In the field guys. Yeah. Let's see if we can make some food.
Is the family in the middle of the world?
Oh, yeah, it's all over there. Oh, there's three lights there. One of them lives in the bed. So how long is that take?
I would highly recommend going to the library and looking and asking for the best kind of book in the library. Amazon, I think it's like $9 on Amazon. Amazon Prime, you know, normal $9.95.
Also, if you go to the CDC website and look up any of these diseases, it gives you a bunch of choices. It tells you about the tick. Identification, ecology of the tick, the ecology of the pathogen, a little bit about the medical condition. There's a whole set of different things you can see. There's different cases. Yeah. That's it. You can get a lot of water.
Yeah.